Previously, we stated that the Earth is energetically open and materially closed. Further, we know that the Sun is most ecosystems' primary energy source, and it travels through ecosystems through food chains, starting with photosynthetic organisms like plants that harness the Sun's radiant energy and turn it into chemical energy within their cells. We'll be digging deeper into energy flow through ecosystems in Topic 8. For now, let's address the primary focus of our chapter, the cycling of matter. Matter can be defined as anything that has mass and takes up space. Water, carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus are all matter. Energy is not matter. Before we address the cycling of matter, let's first investigate two important concepts that relate to how much of a particular substance a specific organism needs or can tolerate. We're going to look at the two topics of limiting factors and range of tolerance. First, limiting factor. Each living thing on Earth has specific nutrient requirements. For example, among many other things, we humans require carbon and nitrogen and phosphorus and calcium and potassium, etc. Other organisms, for instance, a specific plant, may have a slightly different list of nutrients and will likely require different proportions of each nutrient. Further, in some environments, a specific nutrient might be easy to acquire, but in other environments, it might be difficult to find. You can imagine that as an organism grows and consumes the nutrients available to it, it may eventually run out of one particular nutrient that it needs, and thus it is not able to continue growing. In ecology, this is called the limiting factor. I've put the definition here. A limiting factor is the critical resource whose supply determines the population size of a given species in a given ecosystem. Basically, the limiting factor is the one nutrient that is lacking, and if it is added, the organism is able to grow. Plants in agricultural fields are often limited by nitrogen. Thus, farmers use nitrogen-rich fertilizers. Algae and lake ecosystems may be limited by nitrogen as well, but often lakes are limited by phosphorus. Sometimes the limiting nutrient may be site-specific. For example, geologically, Kenyatta College sits on serpentine soils, soils that have weathered from the underlying serpentinite rock. These soils are generally low in calcium, and as a result, many plants cannot grow here. They're limited by calcium. Regardless of the limiting factor, if the factor is depleted, the organism cannot grow, reproduce, or perhaps even survive. On the other hand, if too much of it is present, you may also have a problem. Consider what happens when extra phosphorus is added to lake systems. Algae blooms. Yuck! The algae is stinky and limits swimming, but it can also have detrimental effects on the other organisms in the ecosystem. This process of adding extra nutrients to natural waters is called eutrophication, and we'll cover it later in the course. You've likely heard of phosphate-free laundry detergent. Many states banned phosphate in laundry detergent because phosphorus is often the limiting nutrient in aquatic ecosystems. Most wastewater treatment plants are not equipped to remove phosphates, so high levels of phosphorus were being emitted to rivers, lakes, and streams. The results were massive algae blooms, like you see here, and degraded ecosystem function. Check out the label on your laundry detergent or dishwashing soap. Range of tolerance is another important ecological concept. It seems logical that a population will not flourish if a particular nutrient is below some sort of minimum concentration. However, generally, there is also a maximum concentration above which the population will also be stressed or even unable to survive. The range between these limits is called the range of tolerance. Here's the definition from your text. The range within upper and lower limits of a factor that allows a species to survive and reproduce. Graphically, infographic 8.6 depicts the range of tolerance. Populations have a range of tolerance for all sorts of different factors. For example, temperature, oxygen levels, nutrient levels, etc., could all be on the x-axis there for environmental gradient. There is generally an optimal range for each particular factor. Outside of this range, there may be individuals within the population who are able to survive, but they may be stressed and thus not grow as well or not be able to reproduce as well. Two final points regarding range of tolerance. First, populations with a wide range of tolerance will likely be better able to adapt to changing environmental conditions. And second, range of tolerance for any particular nutrient or condition likely varies during the life cycle. For example, a fish may have different dissolved oxygen requirements when it is an egg versus a small fry versus an adult. Similarly, it may have different needs for temperature or other specific nutrients during each life stage. We now have a basic understanding of two concepts related to the material needs of organisms, limiting factor and range of tolerance. Next, we're going to look at particular nutrients that organisms need to survive and to see how they cycle through ecosystems.